Welcome and thank you everyone for coming. Today we're here to talk about the philosophy of compositing in Nuke and how you can stand out as a junior compositor. My name is Chris Weverley. I'm a product specialist at Foundry. And to give you a little bit of history about myself, I used to be a visual effects artist working on feature films such as Maleficent and Guardians of the Galaxy. I then got the opportunity to join Foundry and the Nuke product team, where I work as a product specialist. And essentially that allows me to be an artistic voice within the company. So any of the designs, the development we do, I get to feedback and provide context on how artists will use it. And I'm one of many voices in the company that does this. Part of my job is also coming to do demos and seminars such as these, so I get to interface with you guys, give back, and get lots of feedback so I can pass that back to the devs. And I do the same thing with our larger clients, so VFX clients from all around the world. And it was actually going to visit these clients that made me want to put this seminar on, because I was talking to their training teams at some of the larger houses, and they kept bringing up the same points and the same things that they're looking for in junior artists new to the industry. So that's what we're going to be tackling today, what you can bring as a junior artist starting in your very first production role and how you can stand out. So I'm assuming most of you, or a lot of you here, are either students or recent graduates or perhaps like self-taught, and you're looking to, get your first production job. With that, I'm assuming also that you probably have a good knowledge of things like tracking, keying, color correction, things like that. So I'm not going to cover any of that. There's loads of resources already available online that cover these topics. And if you don't know any of that stuff or aren't as clued into it, don't worry, the resources are there. Instead, today we're going to look at all these things that you can do that you can sort of showcase when you're applying to big companies or when you first get that job, the things you can do that will really set you apart as a great compositor. So why call it the philosophy of compositing in Nuke? Well, that's simply because philosophy is generally a general guidelines to things. So I want you to think of these as guidelines to what you should be doing when you get into your first production role. So let's get started, get a jump in. So the first thing that you need to think about is script organization and habits. Now, the reason this is first is because script organization is simply one of the biggest and simplest changes that you can make to become a better compositor in production. I even see someone nodding along in the background and pointing out. So it's something really important to focus on. So usually, you're probably, as a student, working with small groups, so one or two compositing artists, and you're probably not sharing your scripts that much between you. You don't have to structure them or organize them that well. But in a large company, you're often working with hundreds of artists. You'll start a shot, someone else will take over, you'll take over their shot, or you'll have multiple artists on a single shot. So you need to make sure that all of your scripts are well organized so that they're easy to understand, easy to troubleshoot, you can make fast changes on them. And something that comes up a lot that a lot of new artists don't really understand is a concept known as developing a shared visual language. So what is a visual language? Well, that's really simple. A visual language simply refers to how you can make a script easy to understand purely by looking at the location of nodes and how they are connected. And this is extremely important and something that you'll learn to develop as you go along. So a really basic example of this is the B-pipe structure. We're all taught when we first start compositing, your background element goes into your B-pipe, which is the spine of your script, and all A elements are your foreground elements, which get merged over the top. This is a great way to get started. But in production, if I jump across to my script, there's loads more reasons to be doing it just than that. So here I have, a production organized level script. You can see that we're taking our B input from the top, and that's acting as the spine of our comp. And one thing that it's doing, apart from just keeping things nicely structured and organized, is maintaining the metadata throughout the comp. And this is really important in production, because you're going to need to deliver that in often cases. So here, when I view my metadata, I can see it. If ever I break that B pipe, so now I'm taking my previous spine and bringing it into a new B pipe section, if I view the metadata now, it's gone. And we can make changes. We can actually add in a merge node and work around this so that we plug in the A input and then use the metadata settings here to bring that across. And you can see this is now updated. But that's something that we're going to have to manually keep eye on and keep track of. And we really want to minimize the amount of things that could cause changes unnecessarily in our script and keep it quite simple. So another aspect of the B pipe input is simply to be able to quickly navigate your script and easily see what's going on. So here, I've built a really simplistic version of our giant script. So when I view it, it looks pretty much the same. And the ability to come in and just disable elements to see what they're doing. So here, I'm just seeing that these elements are adding a light. These elements are adding this flare on the bottom, and likewise the god rays that we're seeing behind the hummingbird. The fact that I can do this is all thanks to the B-pipe integration. If we do the same, but with the A-pipe, it won't work. I'll view the last node, disable it, and we'll just get what looks like a black screen. It's actually like a lens dirt element. There's a tiny lens dirt thing there. And that's because it'll prioritize the B pipe coming in. So that's something just to be, you know, I'm sure we're all already aware of, but part of the reason what we're building on with this visual language with the B pipe. Another aspect of the B pipe that's actually built into Nuke is when I create a merge node and I connect it to my stream, you can see that we have three connectors, the A input, the B input, and the mask input. And these are all purposely laid out with the A input defaulting to the left and the mask defaulting to the right, with the B being the vertical. And that's because Nuke's telling you in its default visual language that you want to put in input your nodes from the left-hand side by default where you can. In doing this, you also want to put your mask in the right. And the reason that you do this is it really helps you when you're looking at your script from a distance. And when you're working, you can use it to read your script so much better. So when I look at this, I can see that all these connectors are coming in from the left, so I know that they're A elements coming in. And if I ever have a merge or like I ever have a mask which I need to change, so there's something wrong with the mask and I need to update it, all I need to do is quickly scan through my script. And if ever I see like a little hook coming in from the right-hand side, I immediately know that this is a mask input. If I wasn't obeying these structures and these rules, then I'd have to be at about this distance where you can just see the orange text to understand that's a mask input. So by structuring this way, I'm making my script so much easier to read and quickly navigate to what I need. And efficiency is going to be a big part of what you need to bring as a compositor, because you're going to be working on tight deadlines. So another part of visual language is how you can represent nodes. So here I have my background element of the hummingbird, and I'm just using a simple roto shape to, you know, outline the head of the hummingbird. And this is all done in one node. It looks clean, it looks efficient, and it looks really simple. And it is. It's, you know, a really good way that you can work. However, instead of working this way, I would advocate using this methodology of using two nodes instead of one. Which, you know, why use two instead of one node? Well, this is because I'm visually communicating to myself when I work through my script what these nodes are doing. So by plugging the roto in to a mask node operation, I know immediately that this is going to be a roto element that I'm stenciling out. If I just have this single roto node, from a distance, that could be an additive or a subtractive element. And what I mean by that is it could either be a roto shape that I'm using to cut out an object, or it might be a roto paint where I'm actually cloning or painting because of that. I won't know until I zoom in and actually look at the properties of the node. Whereas with this setup here, I can easily recognize from a distance, I can see the blue merge mask input, I can see the green coming in from the left, meaning it's an A additive element, and that really gives me a good indication of what's happening in my script. So it's little things like this that you can notice and really structure and plan your scripts to make it easy to read from a distance. The next thing that we're going to look at is node indicators. And this is something that I think is often overlooked by a lot of compositors first starting out. And I think we're all familiar with things like the expression. So whenever you create an expression, you get the nice green bars going across to indicate the link. You also get a little A in the corner to represent animated knob inputs. And you have clones as well. All of these, most people get, really simple. But how many people really understand the X value? Like this simply represents your mix slider and whether it's on a full value of 1 or 0 or not. If you have the X displaying, then it's somewhere in between. And this is really important because, say, I have an element which is showing artifacts, it's for having some transparency or something like that. I might not know where that's happening, but if I end up looking at a node and spotting the X, I can immediately be like, oh, well, I wasn't intending anything to have less than a full mix value, so I can come in and troubleshoot straight away. So knowing these node indicators will help you isolate and pick these values out. Another aspect to it is these colored bars along the bottom. These are really useful, as what they do is they show you the channels you're processing. So the wide bars represent the channels being processed by the node. In this instance, our red, our green, and blue channels. And the thinner bars represents the channels that are passing through the node untouched. Now, the white one obviously represents alpha, and you would normally, if you had all the panels or all the passes, you'd have both the depth. So the depth, and then the motion, the forward, and the backward, all represented along this line. I don't have them on this comp, so like they're not appearing, but that's fine. You also have the green icon on the green indicator on the right, and that just represents that there's other nodes inside of the path that can be represented. So a really good thing to learn is how this channel data is being manipulated, because say if I disable the green channel, I can immediately see it updates, and now I know what passes are affecting what channels. So it's a really nice way to work. So I just want to express the importance of a visual language. It really does help you work with your scripts much more efficiently and also work with other artists a lot better. You'll find actually in different companies there's, you know, different visual languages, and you'll learn, you know, what each company likes to do. But having a base understanding and being aware that this is a concept is going to help you a lot in like developing your scripts and making them much better. The next concept that I'd like to talk about is also massively important when building your scripts, and that's a concept called modularization. And it's simply the act of separating your script into sections that contain unique tools. Now, a unique tool can be anything from a tracker to a grade to a grain, and it's basically about making your script so that each of these elements are placed in their own isolated place, so that it's really easy for you to manage your entire script and make changes when you need to. When you modularize your script, you're making it much more efficient and simpler, which is always a good starting point. And it also makes it easier to spot duplicate tools. So say you're having a really messy script and you're applying a bunch of grains in different areas. Those grains might not be necessary all in several different places. You want to consolidate and just use a single grain on the foreground elements before you merge it over your background. So modularizing your script will allow you to do that. It also has the added benefit of reducing filtering and helping with your bounding box management, which are topics we'll address in a little bit. So let's jump into an example of what this might look like. So here I have an example whereby we're just taking our bird element again. And this time we've been asked to add color to the different sections of the body until we have something built up like this. And this worked. You know, actually, I've achieved the result that my supervisor or the director wanted. But then they've come back and they've asked for a revision. They say, we really like this chest part, but we want the body to change. Well, the way I've set it up, which isn't modularized, if I change the color, then I'm also changing the color. It's bleeding on and affecting the grill. Now, I can work around that by actually stenciling out those elements. So I could say any roto pieces that I have, so these two here which will overlap, I could stencil one out of the other and combine it. And then I can build a structure based around that. And there is one workflow which can work. The trouble is creating all of these setups on a much more complex shot with loads of overlapping rotos, it's going to be a nightmare, to be perfectly honest. You're not going to want to do it. So instead, it's better to do something like this, where we're taking our element, we're applying our color correct, and then we're simply creating that same roto mask structure as I showed before for each individual element of the bird that we want to look at. And in doing so, we can then add them all together in a modular setup. And then whenever I need to make a change, so take that same example of, okay, we like the chest, but we don't want the body to look like this. If I come and view this now, oh, interesting. That's disconnected, that's why. So if I view this now and I need to change that chest element, I can, and it won't affect the front. And like this is how, by modularizing your script, you're preparing for future changes and revisions as well. It also has that added benefit of when filtering. Here I can apply a grain at the very end, and it affects all the objects, so that grain will just shift between the two. Whereas if I had a really messy script and say, like, you know, part of the roto shape was over here, part of it was over here, part of it over here, I'd have to probably apply multiple grains, not because they needed them at those different points, but because they're so separated, I wouldn't recognize that, oh, I could just consolidate them into one single tool before merging it over my backplate. So modularization is a really great way to work and make sure that you know, are keeping your script clean and efficient and allow for flexibility. Another part of it is revisions. So you're going to have, you know, you're going to finish a script when you're done in production environment. You're going to send it off, and it's always going to come back. It's going to come back time and time again, sometimes with minor changes, sometimes with major changes. And you need to be prepare your script so that if changes occur, you can be flexible. A good example of this is here. I've built a horrible-looking little mountain comp. But because I've modularized it, if the director was to look at this and say, oh, I really like this red mountain, but I want it to sit in the middle of my shot, the fact that everything's separated out into its individual modules means it's really easy for me to just move that into place. Whereas if I created a different structure, like the one we showed earlier, it would have knock-on effects, which would have meant that other elements might move along with it. So really thinking about that ahead of time and modularizing your work will help you no end in your flexibility in your revision work. So these concepts all fall into, you know, planning and script management. I know it's not a sexy topic, but it's a really important one, and it's foundational to you as a compositing artist. everything you do is built upon the principles of planning, which is what we're talking about now, structure, which is the modularization of your script and how you organize it, and communication, which is through things like visual language inside the script itself, notes you add, or even just talking to people. Like, these things are foundational, really important. So most junior artists, when they start their first job, they're going to get a comp, they're going to get a shot, and they're going to start working on it straight away. They're just going to dive in to prove what they can do. But really, what we're looking for from a new artist is to spend 10 minutes, or just 10 minutes, thinking on what they actually need to achieve in the shot. In doing so, you can think about, well, what are the best workflows? An example might be, oh, I need to key this shot, apply a new background, like doing a CG rebuild or putting a CG element over the top. So I need to think, oh, well, what's the best keyer to use this? What problems might I incur with this keyer? Maybe there's edges that I need to think about that don't work as well. And think about those potential problems and how you might work around them, or how structuring your script might enable you to build a better workflow. You can also think about what revisions might occur, so what changes might happen later on. What I tend to do is whenever I open a script and like I've got a shot that I need to work on, is I'll just list it out. I'll say, okay, this concept of this shot is that a robotic hummingbird flies out of Mailpipe and goes off screen. It contains no live action, so I'm dealing with CG, which means I need to think about how to correctly add in believable camera elements and to, you know, make it physically believable with the lighting setups. And then I think about potential changes. Well, there might be a changing animation. So those rotos that I made earlier, they might need to be changed. So I need to make sure that they're modularized so that independent of any changes that occur, so that I can quickly update them without affecting the rest of my comp. Same for changing the live action background. I need to make sure the background that I'm merging over the top, it can be easily swapped out in case there's massive changes to that. And this goes on for loads of different things that you can think about. Like, there might be even just changing it to be a rainy scene, for example. So thinking about these things ahead of time will really allow you great flexibility in your work. Another thing that I see with how people plan and structure their scripts, and is kind of a mistake from junior artists, is not working within the original format that you're delivered. So here we're looking at a flare, like lens flare artifact. This is like between 2 to 3K. And our deliverable on this shot is actually in HD 1080. So a common thing I see is that artists will take this high-res deliverable and they'll reformat it immediately to be the deliverable format. Then they'll do all of their work, so they'll end up with exactly what you want. It looks great, it works exactly how we need it to, so when we merge it over, we've got, you know, it looking perfect. But problems occur when revisions happen, and say, like, all of your project suddenly gets upscaled and now it's going to be a 4K deliverable. So you get, you know, your new plates, and I'm just going to use a reformat to represent that here. So these are now 4K. And you think, oh, well, I can just go in and I'll just update my reformat to match. So just open that up, put that into our 4K super. But it doesn't appear, and the reason is simple. All the maths from all the transforms and everything else you're doing afterwards are being affected by the change in the reformat node. By having the reformat node at the top, it's breaking how everything will flow. The better way to work is to work in that original format. So here I'm doing the exact same thing, but rather than having the reformat at the top, I'm just placing it at the bottom once the work is done. And then I'm doing the exact same thing of merging it over the top. And now when we have the project upscaled to 4K, so here's the upscale, again, it disappears. But this time when we reformat it, so put it back into 4K, it will appear exactly how it was before. And this is because all the maths and all the logic still makes sense in the exact same way, and then the reformat has been applied afterwards. So that's something really key to be aware of when working with different footage types and formats. So, bounding box management. This is literally when you get into a job and your supervisor is going to be hounding on you to finish a shot. He's also going to be, or she is going to be, hounding on you to keep your bounding boxes efficient, keep them small, because if you don't, you're going to be processing loads of unnecessary pixel information, loads of unnecessary data. So you want to make sure you have a good working knowledge. So here we have my HD 1080 format. Not sure how easy it is to see the bounding box on the outside, but there's a little bounding box. And if we don't properly isolate this, then, you know, we may want this bounding box, but for instance, in this point, actually don't. It's just processing unnecessary information. So we want to manage that. So I'm just going to jump back in. And this time, we're going to look at that modularized roto section again. And here we have my elements that I'm adding in. So this is our root format again, HD 1080. But then you can see once I create my roto shape, the bounding box shrinks just to match what the roto shape is. And that's because on my merge operation, I'm purposely setting my bounding box to the A input. By default, it will be the union input. And what union does, it takes the bounding box of the B input, which in this case is HD 1080, takes the bounding box of the A input, which is this smaller box, it just combines them together. And in this instance, that's only ever going to result in the root format because it's the larger scale of the two formats. And like it's overlapping the A input. So by intentionally changing this from union to A, I've reduced the amount of pixel data that would be unnecessarily being analyzed. And now I'm just only looking at the special area, that the particular area that I need. And this also works when you're working with, you know, large resolution, larger files than your deliverable format. So here I'm working again with the 2K and 3K footage. And typically you'll see an artist like merge this over, and then we've got this massive bounding box outside the root format. And that's because this is currently set to union, as is by default. So instead, we actually want to pipe in the B input. So the B input format, again, is that HD deliverable. And by specifying that, it means that we bring that down into the working space. Now, a lot of times, artists won't do this, or they don't think you should do this, because they'll be looking at the union operation and say, well, I want to, you know, sometimes affect that flare. I want to move it about, so I want this bounding box space so that I can manipulate the element. Well, Nuke's much cleverer than that. You can still set your merge to be that bounding box. And because this transform's happening earlier, because I've separated out into its own module, I can still manipulate it around and have it, you know, even showcase data that technically exists outside this new bounding box. So a really good way to work is to be very mindful of what bounding box you're setting to it. Know that this is something you should be looking at whenever you're creating a merge and making an active decision on how you want the bounding box to incorporate into your script. So another actual really good thing that I should show you is the auto-crop functionality in Nuke. So very quickly, we have our shot here. And you know, here it's just a hummingbird isolated by itself. And we might want to look at, you know, all this empty space that's currently being used. What we can actually do is we can select that node, hit X, switch over to our Python, and we can run a Python script called nukescripts.autocrop, and it's just open close brackets. And in doing this, here, if anyone's making notes, I'll just make that a little bit bigger for you. And in doing this, it's creating a curve tool which has the autocrop function. And it's just processing, and each frame it's analyzing to what the smallest bounding box is. And it's going to then copy all that data into a crop node and then delete the curve tool that's generating it. I've already created that already, and you can see we've now reduced our bounding box from the entire format just to where it needs to be. And this can be really useful on heavier scripts or elements that you need to make sure you're keeping as efficient as possible. Another thing that I think is really useful is the profile node in Nuke. This is something that was released in 11.1, so you may not have experience with it yet. But it's a great way to come in and analyze your entire comp and find out where the data usage is being hit. So I can look at my script, connect the profile node at the bottom of it, you can connect it anywhere, and then analyze the script. And here I can see that my CPU is being hit hardest by the Z defocus and the read nodes, and likely my memory is also being hit by 40% by the read nodes. So having this information allows me to make much better decisions as to how I want to manage my script. So a good reason for that is these read nodes. Whenever you're creating a read, you only really want to read in footage once. You don't want to have multiple reads all over your comp. So a good way to manage this instead is to use poster stamps. So I've just created a postage stamp here, and I've just disabled the input, so I've just hidden the input. And in doing so, I've created essentially a mock read node that I can connect anywhere. But it's much more lightweight and will keep your script much nicer and much cleaner and more efficient. So in doing that, I can reduce the amount of memory usage that my reads are taking up. Another thing that hits your memory sometimes is that, you know, these actual images on the nodes, if I hit Option P or Alt P, I can actually like hide them. And that will help with really heavy scripts. So just a quick tip to keep you aware of when dealing with much heavier work. Next topic that I want to talk about is the flow of channels and how you can manage and understand channel data. So the concept of channels, typically in production, you're going to be working with multi-channel EXR files, which are going to have loads of channels inside of them. And it's going to be really useful. You get access to great information that you can work with and build upon. But the first thing you should do is really review those channels, look at them, and determine how efficient they are. You know, look to see if there's unnecessary channels being used. You know, say we have a black and white image that's using all the RGB channels, like an ambient occlusion pass, for instance. That just needs one channel to represent that data. Or if there's duplicate alphas or any duplicate data in general, you want to find those, isolate them, and you kind of want to remove them and then, you know, use shuffle and copy nodes to reduce the number of layers you're working with in that multi-channel EXR. And that will help speed things up also. So we'll just jump into a really quick example of that. So here, I've been given a cool shot with this weird-looking alien dude, and inside of it, it's got all these different channels. So we've got a bunch of different channels to work with. And if you've ever not worked with channels properly before, this is usually represented along... We'll view that. This is always represented on the top of Nuke, and here you can see all the different channel data that's available. By default, we're always working RGBA, but I can always select one of these to view this channel data and then, you know, work on it there. Now, with these channels, I'm looking at the contact sheet, and I'm trying to spot for irregularities. So here I have a map pass, which shows the red and the blue, but also it's separated out the top as a green as an individual for no real reason. And neither of these layers has like an alpha to it either. So I can actually combine these later and like take two passes and make them into one. Similarly, because they have no alpha, I also have a texture down here. It's just the texture, it's just a black and white image. So I can apply this as an alpha element if I need. So if I combine these three layers together, then I'll be, instead of having three channels, three layers that I'm having, or passes that I'm having to bring in, I can just combine them into one pass and it'll be much more efficient. And this can be done in numerous aspects. You need to analyze the script. So let's have a look at that then. So all I'm doing is the first thing I do is I take my multi-channel EXR, I split it out into all the different passes that I'm typically going to work with. So here I'm looking at the depth, then the UV, and that's in my utility section, all the mats, the colors, and the lights. And so in my mat section, I'm going to find that you know, map pass, and I'm going to shuffle it using the shuffle node. And if you're unaware of the shuffle node and the copy nodes, don't worry, they're actually really simple, and I recommend like getting up to speed with them, because they will help you in a lot of ways. So all I'm doing here is I'm taking from this channel, so rather than having this channel exist separately, I'm going to bring it into RGBA space using the shuffle node. So I just select that channel from the drop-down list in my one input, pipe the R, the G, and the B across into the RGBA space, and now I can work with that really easily. I do the same for the armor blend colors. Like, this is pretty much just one thing. All RGB are all the same in this instance. But I'm bringing that across, so then in the shuffle copy node, I can bring both of those elements. So the two input is our mask, and in this two input, you can see we're taking that R data, the green data, the blue data, and we're going to pipe it into a new channel that I create, or a new layer that I'm creating. The way you do that is just simply hit new, name it, add in the channels you want, and then hit OK. So I'm going to pipe the red, the green, and the blue from my map pass into my new pass. I'm also going to add the armor blend pass. I'm just going to take the B channel and make that my alpha. And once I've combined all these using the shuffle copy, I now have a new channel that I've created. And in here, you can see that I have the red channel, the green channel, the blue channel, as well as my alpha channel that I've added in. So I've combined all of these things into one single layer. It's so much more efficient, and it's going to help with, you know, your work going forward. The only things left to do, use a copy node, and just copy that layer into your B pipe section, and then simply use a remove node to remove the original layers that you base this on. And once you've done all that, you can render it out with all the channels selected. And instead of having a shot or a multi-channel EXR, which had 24, if ever you see a black and you're not sure why, it's usually because you've selected a channel and you're not picking it up. But instead of having 24 channels, I've now reduced this down to 19. And it's reduced the size from 115 to 95 megabytes, which sounds really insignificant, I know. But like that 20 megabits of data will add up over 1,000 frames. So a really good thing to be aware of. Now, some companies may not actually want you to mess with this stuff, but having a knowledge of how to manage your channel data is really important, because it's going to make you much more informed as to how you can work. Now, some really cool workflow tips on this is we're going to go back to doing our roto example. So here we have the same roto shape that we were working with before. And this time, I want to copy that roto shape using a copy node into my own custom channel called Bird Test Alpha. And I want to use this so that I can use it as a mask later on in my script. So the way I'm going to do that is this blur is just going to represent basically a giant section of the script. And then in the grade node, I can affect only that roto area by using the mask input from that custom channel that I created. By default, this would just apply to everything, but I can set the new mask that I created and build upon that. I can also do that with my with just a normal roto mask input. So here, the grade is just literally feeding off the mask input. And then I can use this inject option inside of the comp, and that's going to save the roto input as a mask, so just its own channel that Nuke creates automatically, so we don't have to go through that process. And again, I can use that later on to affect just specific areas. One thing to note about this, though, is if I then merge this into a B-pipe input, I can no longer use that mask because that channel data is not being brought across. We can quite easily bring it across by in the merge node just saying also merge that mask element, and then I can work with it in this instance on this globe. So it's accessible to me there. It's a really powerful way to maintain channel data and retain alpha data that you can then work with over your comp. So something that may exist all the way over here, you can still bring down your pipe and work with down here without having horrible connections that go everywhere. Another really cool aspect to this is the ability to use mask to isolate paint strokes. So here we're creating a duplicate eye. So we just wanted to use a clone tool using our rotor paint. But the trouble is, if I want to then use just affect only that clone paint, the alpha doesn't represent that. It represents the entire CG object. So what we can do is come into our rotor paint node, and you have this little drop-down arrow, and just output that mask again into that mask channel. And in doing so, you can then use the grade node and specify that same mask input. If by default it would apply to everything, but now we can just isolate that singular paint stroke. So understanding how to work with channels and how they can be really creatively used to maintain data throughout your comp is going to make you much more flexible and quicker in how you work and help with keeping your scripts organized. So just make sure the real takeaway from that is only ever work with the channel data you need at a given point in the script. I think actually something important to highlight is sometimes certain nodes will have all channels set to default, such as the blur. So you want to make sure that you're only specifying, for instance, the RGB if that's the only channel it's affecting. So another thing to look at is filtering. And this is a massive issue because it's really pretty much unavoidable when comping. So it occurs whenever you make a movement or any pixels are moved in Nuke, and Nuke then tries to smooth or sharpens the pixels when the adjustment is made. So it'll happen pretty much in almost every operation in Nuke. So it's not, you can't avoid it. But it's your job as a compositing artist to make sure that you keep the original image to as high a quality as possible. So we talked about modularization helping with this because it's going to help reduce duplicate nodes and therefore keep filtering down to a minimum. But the other aspect is concatenation. Now, hopefully a lot of you are already aware of what concatenation is. If not, we're going to dive in a little bit quickly, but not spend too long on it. But concatenation is really going to help reduce filtering. You're going to make sure that instead of applying multiple maths operations, so here I'm simply scaling down and then scaling up an image, it's going to take both of those multiplications and rather do them individually, just do them both together once at the end of the concatenating nodes, so these two transforms. If I put a node in between that doesn't concatenate, then it's going to do that first scaling effect. We're going to have the other grade in, which won't concatenate, and then we're going to apply the next mathematical operation, and you can see it's now filtering the image, and we're having this horrible comparison between losing a lot of data. So by understanding how nodes and what nodes will concatenate, you can preserve image quality. So how can you know which nodes concatenate? Well, there's no general rule. Like, most of the time, you just have to learn it. But a good tip is that if ever you see the filter knob or the motion blur knobs, then that's usually a good indicator that the node will concatenate upstream and downstream, which basically means you can put the node anywhere in a number of concatenating nodes, and it'll work. And if there's only a filter knob, then that node will likely only concatenate upstream, which basically means you can only place the node at the bottom of the concatenating tree. Now, there's a few little caveats to work with when you're looking at concatenation. For instance, if you have it set up, the filter at the bottom will be the one that applied, so all these other filters won't take effect, just this bottom one. And also, if ever you're changing the motion blur on any of your transform values, then they need to be in a sequential order that's going up, so 0, 0, 0, or just staying level. They can't go 0, 1, 0, or 1, 0, 0, 0. Those aren't going to concatenate. What I actually tend to do is I actually like to just create a preset of all the nodes that concatenate and all the ones that don't, and I just save this out as a tool set. So if you don't use tool sets, they're really good. Just highlight the nodes you want, select create, and then you can save it. And then in any script I create, I can always come in and just create that again and quickly reference it. So that's just a nice way to work. And similarly, actually, I've organized the way my bounding boxes or my backdrops are organized is they have a key, so I know what colors represent what. So for instance, this gray will represent all of my utility nodes, or this blue represents my CG rebuilds, or this green represents color corrections. So working in that way is a really useful way to quickly, from a distance, know what you're looking at. So now we're going to jump across to a section which I'm not really going to be able to touch on too heavily because it's a really in-depth topic, but I want to highlight how important it is. A lot of the time when I'm talking to the larger VFX companies, they're seeing a lot of artists come in without an understanding of really good principles of photography, of color, of light, and these are really what you need to get a handle on to be a great compositor. So these elements are going to be fundamental to informing every decision and action you perform in Nuke, because the believability of your end result directly comes from understanding the physics of what's going on and what happens when you take a photograph and how light interacts in that physical space and with the camera. You need to make it look like everything in your scene was photographed at the same time by the same camera. And again, just to express how important this is an area really overlooked by a lot of junior artists. So taking it away from like the Nuke space, this is as standard as like just knowing color theories and things like that. So a good example is you need to know about color brightness and contrast to integrate all these different elements. You know, the principle of simultaneous contrast is a really good example of this. Here we have the A and the B tiles, and they look different in these values, but that's just purely because of the contrast that we're seeing in the shadow area. When we actually put a color value between the two, we can see they're exactly the same. And this holds true for, you know, the colors as well. So this is made up of three singular colors, but this blue appears slightly different to this one because it's being closely associated with the green. So knowing how your eyes can be misled and tricked is really important because you're going to need to make your comps always start from a physically correct base. So you need to understand how your eyes may be being tricked into seeing something that isn't physically true. Likewise, you need to know the camera basics. As a compositor, you need to integrate elements to look like they believe they were shot from a camera. So if you don't know how to use a camera, if you don't know how it functions, then this is something you need to get a handle on. So you need to know how to manipulate the camera's ISO, the shutter speed, the aperture, and also understand how this can help you analyze a shot to see the luminance, the motion blur, depth of field, and also the camera artifacts. Often it's a really good chance when you're working to actually ask for all the camera information you can get, so the different lenses that were used and things like that. And if you can't get it, then sometimes it's available in the metadata in a shot, so that's a good place to look. So yeah, just make sure you're aware of these things because it's going to be really important to how you realistically blend an element and make it look like it came through the lens of a camera. Depth of field, I don't want to touch on too long because, again, this area is quite a big topic, but just to highlight how depth of field is actually, there's some maths behind it. It's proportional to the square of the distance. Sounds like jargon, but all it basically means is if you double the subject's distance away from the camera, then the depth of field quadruples. And this is really important because then when you're adding depth of field in your shot, you can physically base it upon that and make it completely accurate. And that's always where you want to be starting from. So just knowing those little things is really useful. Similarly, perspective on the camera. As a compositing artist, you're going to be manipulating distances and size relationships all the time. So you need to know how they interact in the real world and through a camera lens. So in this image on the top, this was taken really close to the objects. They look more spaced out and they're less overlapping. This image was taken using the same camera, the same lens, but from further back. And all the objects are now much more overlapping and much more aligned. And this is just purely done from moving backwards away from the object. Now, if you have an object in a scene coming towards you and it's overlapping a bunch of things, you need to be able to replicate this effect, otherwise it's not going to look believable. So really be aware of it. And also, just to highlight, this is not a difference in lenses. This is literally just moving back away from an object. Well. Lens flares and after. So lens flares occur when you have an overexposure of the image sensor, and it's going to cause multiple reflections in the lens assembly. So this is why you tend to have multiple artifacts instead of one. The important thing to note on this, though, is nothing should ever move in front of a lens flare. Like, you should never have a person overlapping a lens flare. It happens. It's the closest thing that happens to the camera. The only times a lens flare should be affected is if the light source gets obscured or something like that. And it's also really important to know with lenses that they're typically generally rectilinear, so designed to produce straight lines. Some lenses are better than others, though, so when combining elements, and especially CG rendered passes, which are typically rendered with a perfect lens, you need to be aware of this so that when you combine them and merge them together, it all acts accordingly. Motion blur. Only thing I wanted to lead about this is sometimes you see someone putting a trail of motion blur behind an object, and that's not physically how it works. It happens equally on both sides of the object, so just account for that. And I just want to, this is what I really wanted to get to. So the maths behind the scenes will make you a really good compositing artist. So part of this is that compositing is simple visual maths. All you're doing is taking one pixel value and changing it using an operation. And understanding this process and what the operation is doing is going to make you much better artists in how you make decisions. I think a really typical example of this is the merge operator. Like, I know when I first started, I'd just merge nodes together and then just scroll through the list and figure out, you know, by looking at it, what made the right thing work. That's something that you should be purposely picking the correct tool for the job. And it's really common for most artists to just use the over, under, screen, mask, and stencil operations. Those can accomplish most of the work you need to do in the comp. Compositing artists will typically only pick the other stuff when they have a specific need for it. So if I just quickly jump in and show some of that. So here we're just going to quickly rebuild the over operation inside of Nuke. So the over operation, if you hover over, you can always see the different options and the maths behind it. So with an over, it's just A plus B times 1 minus A. And we can rebuild that in Nuke. It's important to remember our maths fundamentals. So, you know, multiplications, you do brackets first, then your multiplications, and so on and so forth. So here, I'm going to start with my brackets. So 1 minus A. To represent the 1, we're just going to do a constant. It's all data represents to 1, as we can see with the RGB. And the little a represents the alpha of the alpha channel, of the alpha A input. So that's going to be the alpha of this bird. If it's a little b, it's the alpha of the B input. So I'm just going to shuffle the alpha in. And then all I'm going to do is the 1 minus the A using a merge minus operation. And it's going to give me an inverted alpha. And they're going to multiply this by my B pass, which is my B input. So use a merge multiply. And now we have the inverted alpha giving us the background with the foreground element like stenciled out away from it, so we can see what's happening. And then the final act is just to add that foreground element over the top of the two. And that's how we build a merge. So now we know that it's just simply an inverted, it's just inverted alpha, which we're using to multiply the background by, similar to how we do pre-multiplication, and then adding the final stencil part over the top. The last thing I want to touch on for, you know, masking operations or like merge operations is a lot of people, when they first start, they use the out and the in operations. Well, I'd recommend instead using stencil and mask, because stencil will do the exact same thing as out. So this is me switching between them and nothing's changing. And likewise, mask will do the exact same thing as in. But the difference being that stencil and mask both have your background as the B input, so you're maintaining that B integrity. So always use stencil and mask unless you have a very specific reason to use out and in. So with that, I just want to make a few acknowledgements. A lot of this was pulled from other resources. So you have things like Ron Brickman's author of The Art and Science of Digital Compositing. And this is because we really should build upon the knowledge of what comes before us and help elevate that information. And also, I wanted to make sure that if you wanted to look at this stuff afterwards, you had a reference point to go to. So if a lot of the topics covered were in the digital compositing book, so you can go there and learn more from it. I also recommend Richard Yott. He wrote Light for Visual Artists. I didn't really reference much of it in here, but it's a really useful book that I use all the time when studying. And also highlight two really great compositors, Austin Myers and Joe Rasch, who there's video tutorials that they've put out, which has some really good information on some of the concepts talked about here. If for Austin Myers, if you look for Industry Giant on YouTube, you'll find him there. And Joe Rasch, I think his YouTube channel is Seneca VFX. So just in summary, I just want to wrap up and like give you some things to take away. So make sure you always take time to plan your shots, organize your scripts, utilize modularization and visual language, manage your bounding boxes and channels, and be aware of filtering and the actions you are taking when adding a node. You always need to know what you're doing whenever you add a node. Finally, understand visual maths like we just demonstrated and how a camera and light works. And with that, thank you so much for attending and for, you know, paying attention. And, you know, cheers.